Intelligence is really a matter of measuring things. What things? They're intangible things. So you're talking about operationalizing, right? Defining your variables in a way that you could measure them. And we'll talk about that in a second, a little bit more. But you're also talking about comparing it to something. And you're talking about measuring it under some kind of controlled circumstance. So standardized measures are critical. If you think you've got a test of any kind of abstract concept, you're going to have to prove that you have a test of that. We don't have loosey-goosey, a bunch of touchy-feely, non-scientific concepts in psychology. What we have is things we all believe are real experiences for human beings that are very difficult to capture in an objective metric. But we do have objective metrics for many of these concepts that we have, and we operationalize them. So if I think intelligence has something to do with one's ability to work with information that you might find in school, like reading and vocabulary, maybe drawing or using some kind of spatial ability that you might see in, say, architecture and things of that nature, right? Engineering, ability to use mathematics, manipulate numbers mentally. If I think that's what intelligence is, then guess what kind of test I'm going to devise? Tests that measure those things, those abilities. Well, okay, so you've operationalized it as those kinds of things, but compared to who and compared to what? Because that matters. If I've got a number without a reference point, I don't have much. Let me talk about my hypothetical self-esteem. Most people who understand what self-esteem is would give you that it's a really valid concept. Yeah, I have a feeling of evaluation about myself, either good or bad or somewhere in between. So let's say I come up with what I think is a measure of self-esteem, and you take my self-esteem measure, and you get a 50. What does it mean? Yeah, compared to what? 50 is just a number. So what I need is a standardization sample. I need a norm. I need to give this to a bunch of people. Let's assume for a minute that it's a valid test, which we don't want to assume right off the bat. But for the purposes of discussion, let's say it actually is a good measure of self-esteem. So what I need to do is give it to a lot of people that are representative of the general population. So let's say I give it to a sample of 10,000 people in multiple geographic regions across a lot of different categories of demography, so that we're looking at race and ethnicity and sex and age and socioeconomic status and political persuasion, religious persuasion, and I've got a pretty good representative sample. And what I find out now is that the mean score on my self-esteem measure is 60 with a standard deviation of 10. Now what do I have? You get a 50, and I know right away it's what? One standard deviation below the mean. So now I have a metric that's comparable to other people's scores in a way that is reliable. I can make an interpretation. Now, I don't know if that's a good or bad thing to be one standard deviation below the mean on that particular metric, but what I do know is compared to a sample, a standardization sample, I now have a way of ranking people's performances. Further, I need to have uniform administration and scoring procedures. So let's say I've got my intelligence test and I've got a good standardization sample so that if I get a valid result on it, I can make a pretty good comparison and say that this person in this range, the normal range, the above normal or the subnormal range, and I have in one case a kid that gets given this test in one set of circumstances and I get another kid who's given it in a completely different set of circumstances. So over here, if you know about intelligence testing, you'll know that it's very strict on how you're supposed to read the stimuli if you're reading it, how you're supposed to present it if it's visual, how you're supposed to give amount of time on some things and cut them off at this point, or give them a prompt, but only this kind of prompt on this kind of question, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's very regimented how you're supposed to give these tests. So let's say that my administrators are both very diligent about administering it. And over here, I got a kid who has to take the test after having been up all night with parents fighting, right? Hadn't really slept, got up, hasn't had breakfast, it's cold in a room, maybe the room is just one they put together for the purposes of this test, maybe it's not much more than a closet, so it's cramped, it's cold, it's dim, I'm hungry, I'm irritable, I'm tired. And in this case over here, I got a kid of the same age who had a great night's sleep, comes from a family that's really high functioning, got up to a good breakfast, comes into a testing room that's well lit, that has nice temperature controls in it, and they're not irritable, they're not hungry, and they're not tired. Would those factors affect performance on these tests?
Yes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you actually have instructions on how you're supposed to set things up. And you have to take all test scores with a huge grain of salt, right? Especially with children. Because what if their motivation varies? This kid just doesn't want to do this over here. Maybe this kid really wants to do it and is able to perform well despite these negative environmental circumstances. But this kid has all the great environmental circumstances going, but doesn't really want to do this. Is not paying attention, is bored, isn't really giving their best effort. So you see, what you get is not the kid's intelligence. What you get is a score on an operationalized set of definitions of a very abstract concept that people call intelligence. And as we'll see when we go through it, there's a lot of different interpretations as to whether there's only a couple kinds of intelligence or whether there's lots of kinds of intelligence. But intelligence tests typically measure the kinds of variables that predict whether one would do well in school environments, where you are focused on things like vocabulary and reading and writing and mathematics and et cetera, right? So, keeping that in mind, if you add something else to the mix, which is a test giver who's not adhering to the rules, they can really screw up the results. And people's lives, well, you would say a lot of people, like, why is this relevant to me? Well, if you don't have kids, you might have kids. And they might get tested one day, and you might want those tests to be valid indicators of their abilities so that if they happen to be subnormal, that they get the special educational incentives and interventions that they deserve to maximize their abilities. And at the other end, they're gifted, that they actually have differential education that's geared towards maximizing their abilities at that level, and that if they are normal, that they aren't accidentally thrown in this category or that category, which might not serve them as well. So it's real. People make lifelong decisions. In some cases, in the criminal justice system, they decide whether or not a person convicted of a crime could be executed based on scores on these kinds of measures. It's not supposed to be just a score, because we don't know what your real score is. We don't know what your true score is. We know what your actual score on any given day might be. And if all conditions are excellent, it might be a pretty good indicator of your true score. But a true score is a hypothetical construct. If I could get you to take the test on every given day that I could, which I can't because now you've seen the test and you have practice effects, right? And I averaged all of those on the days you had a good day, the days you had a bad day, the days you were tired, the days you weren't tired, the days you gave your all, the days you weren't really motivated, then I would have all those averaged and that'd be kind of your true ability. But since we can't do that, we get one score and we have to put a confidence interval around it. And if you remember what we're talking about from the normal distribution, right, having a 70 at a 95% confidence interval, we might say that there's, gosh, a 5-point window around that. 70 plus or minus 5, which means at a low end it might be as low as 65. At a high end, it's clearly over 70. And the higher confidence you want, the wider that window gets. And so those things are important to understand. Further things to understand in psychometric properties, you got to give these tests to large representative samples. So that's what Wechsler did. Various age groups of adults, they didn't have data from adults before that, so you kind of lost the utility of having a metric. That's why we didn't have the IQ intelligence quotient anymore. You don't have anything to compare it to the normal 30-year-old, the normal 40-year-old, the normal 50-year-old, the normal 60, 70, 80-year-old, so you need to get a wide sampling from all populations, and the test has got to be given the same way to everybody to be considered to have a good state of validity, although that's a little bit different than what we're going to talk about here in a second. So looking at the deviation scores of IQs, well, IQ scores change over generations. They actually are going up generation after generation after generation. It's called the Flynn effect. We don't actually think that human beings are getting radically smarter and smarter every generation, but what do you have each generation? More and more information, right? Access it earlier and earlier. My little niece is 2 years old and she knows how to operate an iPhone, right? And if she knew how to Google, if she could talk, right, she could be Googling things like, you know, I don't know, what's that princess show? Princess Sophia. Y'all know that one? See, when you have kids, you know all this stuff like Barney and Teletubbies and et cetera, et cetera. That's old hat. Nobody watches that no more. It's new stuff. But you see what I'm saying? As generations have moved through the process that we've developed these tests, each generation has access to substantially more information earlier in their lives. And so what do? Renorm the tests. Renorm the tests. And it's always statistically transformed that your mean is always going to be 100. This is what we talked about before. Your standard deviation is always going to be 15, right? And so one standard deviation below the mean to one standard deviation above the mean, there's 68% of the people. That's normal intelligence. That's the normal range. It's a pretty broad range. 85 is not the same as 115. It's two standard deviations apart from one another. But within that realm, that's how we define normal intelligence. So it's a practical dividing of people by their scores on what? A test. Again, be very careful not to confuse a person's mental abilities with human value, because they're not related in my way of looking at it. Again, there are a lot of brilliant people who are total assholes, right? And there are a lot of people who are not brilliant, they're on the other end, that are wonderful human beings. So we as a society tend to value this end of the spectrum because it has practical applications, right? You can solve problems, you can invent things, you can interact in ways with information that make you more adaptive in certain situations. In fact, most people in here are here and over. Yeah, I can be right here and work really hard and make a good grade in a class and get a college degree, but if I'm over here, it's not going to happen that way. And just because I'm out here doesn't mean that I'm going to do well. Because then you get into things like motivation and work ethic and other kinds of factors. So be really careful when you're looking at these numbers, not to treat people like numbers. But the numbers are important for understanding the concept.